Could y'all come to my house at 10 o'clock tonight and play that as I fall asleep? That would be perfect. Wonderful. Well, good morning.
Good morning.
Pastor Inger is taking some well-deserved vacation, and I'm privileged this morning to be your guide for worship. A couple of things I want to draw to your attention. The drive for appliances for Hillcrest continues. There's still an opportunity to give for that, and Gordy tells me we're over $55,000 already. So thank you for all your giving. Well, this is MEA this week, so please note there's no programming here at all on Wednesday. And then I'm sad to announce that Thursday morning, surrounded by Marilyn and two of her sons, Bill's sons, Bill Keel died in the Lord at the Northfield Hospital. The visitation will be held here at Bethel tomorrow from 4 to 7. The service will be at 11 o'clock Tuesday morning with the visitation an hour before and a lunch to follow. And I can't help but look over here and think that Bill should be sitting right there. The call committee later in the service will have a survey for you. But now it's time for worship. Will you please stand? Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God who creates, redeems, and sustains us and all of creation.
Amen.
Amen. We can face forward as we sing our Kyrie.
Have mercy on us, Lord, and hear our solemn prayer. Thank you.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Please be seated and let us join together in the prayer of the day.
Let us pray.
O Lord God,
timeless guardian of your people, you are always ready to hear our cries. Teach us to rely day and night on your care. Inspire us to seek your enduring justice for all this suffering world. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Our first reading comes from the 32nd chapter of Genesis. The same night, Jacob got up and took his two wives, his two maids, and his 11 children, and crossed the ford of the Jabbok. He took them and sent them across the stream, and likewise everything that he had. Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him until daybreak. When the man saw that he did not prevail against Jacob, he struck him on the hip socket, and Jacob's hip was put out of joint as he wrestled with him. And he said, "Let me go, for the day is breaking." But Jacob said, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." So he said to him, "What is your name?" And he said, "Jacob." Then the man said, "You shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel. For you have striven with God and with humans and have prevailed." Then Jacob asked him, "Please tell me your name." But he said, "Why is it that you ask my name?" And there he blessed them. So Jacob called the place Peniel, saying, "For I have seen God face to face, and yet my life is preserved." The sun rose upon him as he passed Peniel, limping because of his hip. Word of God, word of life.
Gospel.
Lord,
chapter of Luke.
Glory to you, Lord.
Then Jesus told them a parable about their need to pray always and not to lose heart. He said, "In a certain city, there was a judge who neither feared God nor had respect for people. In that city, there was a widow who kept coming to him and saying, 'Grant me justice against my opponent.' For a while, he refused. But later, he said to himself, 'Though I have no fear of God and no respect for anyone, yet because this widow keeps bothering me, I will grant her justice, so that she may not wear me out by continually coming.' And the Lord said, 'Listen to what the unjust judge says. And will not God grant justice to his chosen ones who cry to him day and night? Will he delay long in helping them? I tell you, he will quickly grant justice to them. And yet, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on earth?'" The gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Please be seated. I'd like to invite the children up this morning. I need some help, as always. Come on, I need some helpers. I brushed my teeth. I showered. Ah, here comes Magdalene. Thank you for coming up. You are brave. So I've been thinking, you know, that most people have a first name and a middle name. I know your first name is Magdalene.
Yeah.
Do you know where that name comes from?
Mary Magdalene.
Yes, it's from the Bible. What's your middle name?
Linda. It's my grandma's.
Your grandma's name. Very cool. So my first name is Phil. I'm named after my uncle Phil. My middle name is Robert, and that was my dad's name. Our names are pretty important, aren't they? Pretty special. So let me ask you, have you ever been called not a very nice name?
Yes.
Yeah. Do you remember what it was? You don't have to say it.
Idiot.
Idiot. That is not a nice name, is it? Sometimes, sometimes when we're angry, or when we're not very nice, we say mean names. And when it comes to using God's name or our names, God wants us to speak our names with love and respect. Sometimes we all need that reminder. And I appreciate Magdalene Linda for you coming up today. Thanks so much. Well, the first reading this morning has got me thinking about names. And I don't know if you saw the title of this homily. It's "What's in a Name?" You might think this story to be a little silly, but it wasn't for me then. When I was growing up, of course, I didn't have gray hair. I didn't have blonde hair either. I was what the old timers called a towhead. How many of you know what a towhead is? Yeah, my hair wasn't blonde, it was white, totally white. And my dad was a very generous man, but he was also very thrifty and very frugal, so he would cut my hair with the dog clippers. Nice, yeah. He would oil it up. I just remember the oil going down my neck and down my back. And in spite of the oil, that clippers got so hot, it almost burned me. And then he would press it on my scalp and cut off literally all of my hair. And I'd say, "Dad, please cut it a little longer, please." And he'd say, "I can't. I don't know how to do that. I'm not a barber." And I wanted to say, but I didn't. "So why are you cutting my hair?" So when he was done, I was literally as bald as a cue ball. And I didn't want to go to school. And sure enough, when I came to school, all the other kids in my class came and they rubbed my head and they laughed, and this was my name, Peach Fuzz. Yeah, you're laughing, and I understand it, but it wasn't funny. I hated that name. Well, we might think the name Jacob is kind of an innocent name. You know, a lot of people are named Jacob now in our world, and it's a common name and it's a good name. But the name Jacob in the Bible wasn't a great name. Jacob is one of two, he and his brother Esau, and he's born grabbing the heel of his brother. That's what the name means, heel grabber. And it's like these two brothers were struggling and wrestling with each other to see who would be first, who would be number one right away, even before they were born. And then it didn't make matters any better that Esau was his father's favorite. Jacob was a mama's boy. He was his mother's favorite. And when you play favoritism, that rivalry gets even worse. Esau was a hunter. He was out hunting, and he got so hungry, he came back home, and he was starving. And Jacob connived to get the birthright by giving Esau some soup that he had made. Jacob the heel grabber becomes Jacob the conniver. And now if we were to go a little farther along in the story, their father is dying. And at the mother's suggestion, Jacob deceives his blind father and says that he is Esau. And Jacob receives the blessing at the death of his father. When Esau learns this, he is so angry that he has vowed after their father has died, he's going to kill his brother. Bible stories aren't neat and tidy, are they? So after Isaac dies, at the instruction of his mother, Jacob goes and lives with her brother, his uncle Laban. He's there for many years. And now we pick it up with the reading today that Jacob has decided to go home. He's decided to go back. And he learns as he's heading back that Esau is coming to meet him with 400 men. And so he wonders, is my brother still planning to kill me? And there in the night, perhaps out of fear, perhaps out of guilt, Jacob doesn't sleep all night long. He wrestles with this strange, mysterious visitor. And finally, he won't let that visitor go until he receives a blessing. And the blessing that he receives is the gift of a new name, a better name. Jacob the cheat. Jacob the deceiver, the liar, is now going to be Israel. The gift of a new name and a better reputation. So I'm wondering, friends, have you ever had a night where you couldn't sleep all night? A night where maybe you were troubled by your conscience over something that you had done or not done? Maybe something that you had failed to do, or maybe you have a challenge before you and you're just not sure you're up for it. Or maybe you're wondering, what are people saying about me? What are people thinking about me? Who do they say that I am. I've had nights like that. I suppose every time I preach, I'm going to wonder, so what are they going to say? We come here, friends, I come here along with you to be reminded of our name. The world can give us names, the world can try to put us into a mold, and sometimes we give ourselves names like not good enough, loser, or maybe the name Magdalene said. And yet we come here and we're told who we are, sinners washed in the waters of our baptism. We are God's beloved children with whom God is well pleased. Beloved child of God, that's your name. That's who you are. Live in that name and let the love of God carry you in confidence and in grace. Amen. Let's stand as we sing the hymn of the day together.
On the second verse. Maybe.
Come all thou traveler,
be seated.
Let us pray. In gratitude and humility, let us join together in prayer on behalf of all God's creation. O God, rich in mercy, fill your church with righteousness, faith, love, endurance, and gentleness. Empower the baptized by your Spirit to be rich in good works and ready to share. This week, we especially pray for our siblings in Christ at St. Dominic's Catholic Church. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. We pray for air and sky, clouds and sun, that they provide rain to parched lands and relief to flooded ground. Renew and restore our polluted atmosphere and empower us to be worthy stewards of creation. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. For judges, juries, and all who work in the judicial system, that they may desire wisdom, seek truth, rule with fairness, and have the courage to do what is right. Eliminate oppression and injustice in our criminal justice system. This week, we pray for the people of Ukraine and Russia, and for all people suffering the violence and disruption of war. Hear us, O God. Give food to the hungry. Set the captives free. Lift up those who are bowed down. Watch over the stranger. Tend to those who are ill. In our congregation, we especially pray for Barb Holmgren, Marianne Call, Eric Frank, Krista Middlebrooks, Tyler Holes, Luther Twitten, Jan Roberts, Chuck Sandstrom, Deanne Gray, and Ken Larson. And for those seeking long-term care, Wyatt Jackals, Ted Vesey, Chad Holes, Don Kloster, Lenore Cast, Marianne Resendez, Jerry Williams, Earl Faulkner, and all others we name out loud or in our hearts. Stir us to act in the best interest of our neighbors. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Enfold the saints who have died in the arms of your loving care. Grant that the holy angels accompany us and bring us to eternal life with them in the light of your presence. Comfort those who mourn, especially Robin and Anders Peterson on the death of Glenn Peterson, Marilyn Cole and family on the loss of Bill this past week, Avis Pedersen and her family on the death of her son Luke, Jean Mueller and her family on the passing of her brother Dale, the Lear family on the loss of Joel's mother Joanne. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Gather together in the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit, gracious God, we offer these and all our prayers to you through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
For the sharing of the peace today, I'd like you to invite you to turn to somebody next to you and say, "You are a child of God." Good morning, Asher.
Good morning.
You are a child of God. This is Torin?
Yep.
Torin, you are a child of God. And Stephen, you are a child of God. What's that? You are a child of God. Tell me your first name.
Ella.
Ella, right. For our offertory hymn this morning, please turn to ELW 769. 769, we'll sing stanzas 1 and 4. 1 and 4. God of all creation, all you have made is good, and your love endures forever. You bring forth bread from the earth and fruit from the vine. Nourish us with these gifts that we might be for the world signs of your gracious presence in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Holy, mighty, and merciful Lord, heaven and earth are full of your glory. In great love, you sent to us Jesus, your Son, who reached out to heal the sick and suffering, who preached good news to the poor, and who, on the cross, opened his arms to all. In the night in which our Lord Jesus was betrayed, he took bread, he gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After the supper was ended, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them to drink, saying, "This cup is the New Testament in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." We pray together the prayer our Lord has taught us. Lord Jesus, remember us in your kingdom as you teach us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Please be seated. I want to remind you that all of you are welcome to the Lord's table. This is the Lord's table. It's not a Bethel table. It's not a Lutheran table. All of you are welcome. If you need gluten-free bread, just ask for that. If you don't receive this sacrament but want a blessing, just cross your chest. We'll continue with the Lamb of God. Carol, the body of Christ.
Thank you.
Let us pray. God of the abundant table, you have refreshed our hearts in this meal with bread for the journey. Give us your grace on the road that we might serve your neighbors with joy. For the sake of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Ben Fisher, the chair of the call committee, now is going to lead us in a congregational survey. So, Ben, thank you.
Good morning, everyone. So we're going to be handing out these surveys. Their different call committee members are around the sanctuary. So we'll hand out these surveys. And then once everyone gets a survey, I'll give you some direction on how to do that. We'll also be handing out some pencils if you don't have any. So don't worry about that. Okay, while those are being passed out, I'll just kind of talk a little bit. This survey is one of two surveys that we'll be doing, one this week and one next week. And this survey has to deal with what you as a congregation feel are the five most important tasks that you think an associate pastor or a deacon we should be looking for in a call committee. So I know you're going to look at the list and you might think all of them are important, and not saying that they aren't, but I want you to individually look at that and please choose only five. So this is the bigger part of the ministry site profile that we will in turn turn into the synod, and then eventually we'll get transferred to candidates who want to apply for the position. So this is important work and important information that we need for the ministry site profile. So we do appreciate your time in taking and looking at this and discerning what you think individually is important. So when you're done filling out the survey, you can either bring it up to me or hand it to the other call committees that are throughout the sanctuary. So go ahead, take your time and if you happen to have extra ballots, please bring them up here. We don't want to be accused of overstuffing the ballot box. So. I do want to add that anybody that's streaming with us online, you will have an opportunity to fill out this survey electronically. So, and then again, if you're not able to be here next week, you will be able to fill out the second survey that we're doing. You will be able to do that electronically as well. So. I think it looks to me that everyone got a chance to fill it out and all collected. All right, thank you everyone. And we will definitely share with you the results when everything's compiled, so you know what the results were. And I'll turn it back over to the professional. So.
One announcement, there will be no Bethel U in the sanctuary this morning, but definitely go to the youth room, and Bo Aylin and Bob Call will be leading a good program, Lectionary Radio, linking music to scripture, and it'll be great. So I direct you there. Please stand for the benediction. God, who gives life to all things and frees us from despair, bless you with truth and peace, and may the Holy Trinity, one God, guide you always in faith, hope, and love. Go remembering who you are and bring that blessing to others. Our sending hymn, 545, 545.